Return, my soul, enjoy thy rest. Improve the day that God has blessed. O come, let us sing unto the Lord, O God. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and make a joyful noise unto the Lord with psalms. For the Lord our God is a great God and a great King above all gods. Happy Sabbath, my brothers and sisters in Christ. This is the day that the Lord has made, blessed, sanctified, and set apart for us to worship him. I trust that as you enter his presence today, your hearts will be joyful and that you will have an attitude of gratitude because our God is worthy of all praise, honor, and glory. My name is Gretel Bellanton. On behalf of Pastor Lionel Martel and the Spring Valley Seventh-day Adventist Church family, I would like to welcome all those who have tuned in to worship with us today. A special welcome to our visitors and friends. We are truly happy that you have chosen Spring Valley as your place of worship today. I want to assure you that you have made a right choice and will not be disappointed because the Lord has a special blessing reserved just for you today. Today's program has been coordinated and specially designed by the Medical Missionary Department to equip and empower us to develop and maintain a vibrant, healthy, and spirit-filled life. Remember, your God has the perfect plan for your life. He desires you to prosper in all things and be in health, even as your soul prospers. You can't afford to miss out on your blessing today. So please stay tuned, stay focused, listen to the Lord as he speaks to your heart today. Surrender your life to him. Have a wonderful and blessed Sabbath. Our opening hymn is number 229. All hail the power of Jesus' name.
All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Let every king, let every tribe on this terrestrial ball, to him all majesty ascribes and crown him Lord of all. To him all majesty
Our scripture reading this morning comes to us but from the book of Matthew, chapter 18, 21 through 33. And I read, "Then Peter came to him and said, 'Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Up to seven times?' Jesus said to him, I do not say to you up to seven times, but up to 70 times seven. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a certain king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. And when he had begun to settle accounts, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. But as he was not able to pay, his master commanded that he be sold with his wife and children and all that he had, and that payment be made. The servant therefore fell down before him, saying, Master, have patience with me, and I will pay you all. Then the master of that servant was moved with compassion, released him, and forgave his debt. But that servant went out and found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. And he laid hands on him and took him by the throat, saying, Pay me what you owe. So his fellow servant fell down at his feet and begged him, saying, Have patience with me, and I will pay you all. And he would not, but went and threw him into prison till he could pay the debt. So when his fellow servants saw what he had done, they were very grieved and came and told their master all that had been done. Then his master, after he had called him, said to him, You wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you begged me. Should you not also have had compassion on your fellow servant, just as I had pity on you? Amen.
This is the moment when God's people come together to give him praise and to give him honor and to give him the glory that he deserves. So at this time, we are going to lift our hearts heavenward as we pray. As the song says, praise my soul, the King of heaven. To his feet thy tribute bring, ransomed, healed, restored, forgiven. Who like thee his praise should sing? Praise him, praise him, praise the everlasting King. Yes, 'tis the blessed hour of prayer, when our hearts lowly bend, as we gather to Jesus, our Savior and friend. If we come to him in prayer, his protection to share, oh, what a balm for the weary, oh, how sweet to be there. Loving God, eternal Father, Prince of Peace, here we are, O God, yet another Sabbath morning, giving you praise and honor and glory for who you are. Lord God, we recognize that there is none like you. And this morning, dear God, we have come to lift your name. We've come to praise you, dear God. We've come to worship you for who you are. We thank you so much, dear God, for this privilege and this opportunity of allowing us to see yet another Sabbath day. Lord God, your people around the world are worshiping you today, dear God, because, Lord, we recognize that you are Lord and you are creator of it all. So, Father God, we say thank you for who you are. We praise you. We worship you, oh God, and we've come to adore you. This morning, dear God, as I come before your throne of grace, petitioning before your people, I pray now, dear God, that you will make me what I ought to be. And I can only do that, oh God, through the power of your Holy Spirit. So, Father God, at this time, I ask that your Holy Spirit will take full control of my mind. Take full control, oh God, of my thoughts. As I pray now, dear God, that you will wash me afresh. Oh God, may you cleanse me from all unrighteousness, Father, and make me what you want me to be. Father God, again, I pray that as a people, Father, Lord, we will remember you and give you your due, and that is to honor you, dear God. So we thank you, Father God, for who you are. And we thank you, dear God, for sending your son, Christ Jesus, to die in our stead. Oh God, as the song says, when I think of the goodness of Jesus, and all he has done for us. Our hearts should cry out, hallelujah, praise God for saving us today. Dear God, we say thank you for your saving grace. We say thank you, dear God, for the cross. We say thank you, dear God, for your son, Jesus. The name Jesus, oh God, there is something about that name. That name, oh God, when we call upon it, God, souls are saved. When we call upon that name, dear Jesus, hearts are touched, hearts are blessed, God, because in that name, oh Father, there is healing, there is power, there is victory, Lord, there is assurance, God, there is hope. Oh God, we give you praise and we give you thanks for the name, that name, Christ Jesus. So right now, dear God, as we lift your name, Lord, we give you praise. We give you honor and we give you glory for who you are, dear God. Lord, here your people are yet another Sabbath morning. We have come, oh God, to be blessed. And we know, dear God, that a blessing is indeed in store. As we celebrate you today, dear God, and we recognize this day as Health Emphasis Day. Father God, we put you in the midst of it all because it's nothing about each and every one of us. It's all about you. And so this morning, dear God, we come to give you praise. We come to give you honor and we come to give you glory. We pray, God, that you will bless your people. Father, Lord, we bring before you the sick among us this morning. There's so many of us are sick. Some are sick mentally, some are sick physically, some are sick socially. But Lord, when we look around in this nation and in the world, oh God, we see a sickness is plaguing your people. Oh Father God, we pray this morning that you will heal this nation, heal this land, oh God. And we know that you have the answer, Father, because there is nothing that you cannot do. And we know, dear God, that you have never lost a battle. So this morning, dear God, we present the sick before you. Lord, we present the churches before you too. We are on lockdown, oh God, but thank God we are not locked out. And so, God, this morning we say thank you for this opportunity and this privilege by which we can pray and we can praise you through this medium. Lord, we know that you can always find a way where it seems to be no way. And so this morning, dear God, we say thank you for who you are. Lord, we bless your name. We magnify you, dear God. We pray now, Father, that you will be with each participant this morning. And we pray, God, that by the power of your Holy Spirit, that you will lead us and direct us into all truth. Lord God, again, we pause to bring before you the speaker of the hour, Pastor Daly by name. Lord God, we pray a special anointing on him. Oh God, we pray now that you will touch him from the crown of his head to the sole of his feet. God, he is your servant and he's been working so hard in your vineyard, God, just to win souls for your kingdom. Lord God, as we celebrate today, we know, dear God, that this work of the medical missionary is the right hand of the gospel. And we know, dear God, that it is leading sin-sick men to the man of Calvary. And so this morning, God, we give you praise, we give you honor, we give you glory as Pastor Daly brings the word to us. We pray, God, that our hearts will be blessed and our hearts will be receptive. We ask, oh God, that you will be with the entire program for today. And we ask now, dear God, that you will have your own sweet way. Thank you, dear God, for those that have tuned in and even those that are willing to be honored this time. We pray, God, that we will all have a blessing today as we avail ourselves to be used by you through the power of your Holy Spirit. Lord, at this time, we just want to denounce the enemy and we pray, God, that all focus will be on you. So today, dear God, and at this moment, we say thank you for who you are. Thank you for what you will do and will continue to do as we give you thanks. In Jesus' name we pray with thanksgiving. Amen and amen.
Good morning, everyone. Happy Sabbath. Good morning, everyone. Happy Sabbath to everyone. Today is Medical Missionary Day. Health emphasis, and our emphasis on in the image of God. And Pastor Daly will be preaching on forgiveness and how it is related to the image of God. Brothers and sisters, this world has been visited by the majesty of heaven, the Son of God. And he has said, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whomever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Christ came to the world as the expression of the very heart and mind and nature and character of God. He was the brightness of the Father's glory, the expressed image of his person. Christ stood at the head of humanity in the garb of humanity, so full of sympathy and love was his attitude that the poorest was not afraid to come to him. He was kind to all, easily approached by the most lowly. He went from house to house, healing the sick, feeding the hungry, comforting the mourners, speaking peace to the distressed and soothing the afflicted. He was tender, merciful, and gave his children hope. Christ stands before us as the pattern that medical missionary should take. He's the great medical missionary, an example for all who would come to him. And brothers and sisters, as we go forth here, we know that COVID-19 has put us in that position to go and meet the needs of God's people with education on the 8 laws of health. Let us go forth to express his love, arm in arm, as medical missionaries proclaiming the third angel's message and bringing others to the man of Calvary, Jesus Christ. We are medical missionaries in the field reaping the harvest for the great physician. God bless each and every one as we listen and participate today. We are to do the same work that the great medical missionary Jesus Christ undertook in our behalf. We are to follow the path of self-sacrifice trodden by Christ. A blessing awaits us today as we go forth to proclaim Jesus in all we do as medical missionaries. But lastly, but not least, I'm calling all nursing attendants, nurses, physicians, nurse practitioners, dentists, and all medical personnel to join us in the army of medical missionaries to go forth healing and teaching others about the master, the great physician, Jesus Christ. So as we ponder these words that we're going to hear today, let us make a commitment to go forth and teach others the 8 laws of health, to heal and to bring others to the man of Calvary, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
You know this one. Everybody clap your hands and say, these are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness be. And though these are the days of great trial, of famine and darkness and sword, still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, we're building a temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest. The fields are as wide in the world. And we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the world. Because comes my favorite part. This is my favorite part because it is a reminder that there is no God like our God. There is not one person in your life that can be the God that has reigned over you. So if you know the words, you're going to repeat after me. You'll say, there's no God. There's no God. There's no God. Say, there's no God. There's no God. There's no God. There is no God. Say, there's no God. There's no God. Nobody like him. No one stands before him. Say, there's no God. Oh, there's no God. There's no God. One more time.
The Lord. Good afternoon, my brothers and sisters in Christ. It is certainly, certainly a wonderful day to praise our God, in whom we live and move and have our very being. We want to thank our musicians for the marvelous job that they have done, because indeed there is absolutely no God anywhere in this universe of ours just like Jehovah. And we thank God for our young people, and we also are grateful for the fact that we could see this done within the context of our home church, because so many of us are homesick and just itching to get back into the house of the Lord. So we praise God for that today. We also want to thank God for a marvelous young man of God in the person of Pastor Leroy A. Daly, that he has taken out the time to come to us to share with us one of the most profound messages that we have in our possession today. Our health message, his theme will still be relevant and pertinent, but I just want to say to those of you who might not know him that Pastor Leroy A. Daly is the director of the Health and Temperance Department of the Great Northeastern Conference of Seventh-day Adventists. He has been doing a very notable job in that department for several many years. I understand that Pastor Daly was attracted to the Seventh-day Adventist faith through the health message. And ever since, that is for the past 40 years or so, he has fallen in deep love with the message, him and his wife and family trying their level best to adhere to the principles of good health while sharing with fellow colleagues and those who are infirmed by sickness and disease. We understand that he was a graduate from Northern Caribbean University with a bachelor's degree in theology, also from Andrews University with a master's of divinity degree, and from Drew University with a doctor of ministry degree in pastoral counseling. So he comes to us well qualified. Then he is also certified as a family life educator. Amen. So if you're having issues and problems with your family members that seem to be insurmountable or irreconcilable, you might want to talk to him about a session. He has pastored several churches in the Great Northeastern Conference of Seventh-day Adventists and has been serving as the Health Ministries Director for well over 12 years. As Health Ministries Director, his vision is to make New York a symbol of what God wants to see done around the world in terms of medical missionary work. To help fulfill this God-given vision, God has enabled him to train and employ an army of over 1,800 well-trained medical missionaries. God has opened the door for them to minister to some of the largest non-Adventist churches, public schools, and government organizations. They have seen souls accept Christ as their personal savior and become members of his remnant church. We believe the best is yet to come. Amen. With the support of the Northeastern Conference administrators, he has been instrumental in conducting a wellness retreat for pastors and their spouses and in establishing the Victory Wellness Center in Hyde Park, New York. God has blessed Pastor Daly with a beautiful wife, and those of us who know her knows that she's such a precious gem. She's a diamond among us. Sister Sherilyn Daly. Together, they have been married for over 38 years, and they have two beautiful children. She has been such a source of inspiration to him over the years, a very faithful partner in ministry. We know that. We know that. Those of us who know her knows the kind of blessing that she is to her husband as well as to us all. Sherilyn is a retired director of nursing and presently works from home in a natural health education business. God has blessed Pastor and Sister Daly with two children, Darren and Dana, a lovely daughter-in-law, Karen, and three grandsons. He believes that the secret source of joy in the family is the active presence of the Holy Spirit in the family. His prayer is that we will catch God's vision of working to make every member of a gospel medical missionary, and every member a medical, and every church a medical missionary center. Also, we will use the health message to lead men and women, boys and girls, to Jesus, the great medical missionary, the divine healer of body, mind, and spirit. Well, my friends, Pastor Daly would like us to be aware of two upcoming events that promise to be a true blessing to the body of Christ. And the first one is that from Friday, January 8th to the 23rd, 2021, the Northeastern Conference Health Ministry will be presenting the healing of the nations. The healing of the nations. Pastor Daly wants us all to just get on board. That's what he's saying, bottom line. Get involved, get on board. And the second one is our online missionary training. He wants us, if possible, to get onto that too, because some of us need to be trained. Some of us need to be certified. I just got certified. My wife is certified. There are other members of our church, Sister Moore, Sister Brooks, Sister Drisdale. There's a host of us, Sister Lucas. There's a host of us who are certified, and it would be nice if we could get as many as possible in our church to be certified, to get involved in this training, and to become the official medical missionary workers that God would have us to be for these last days in particular. So this online medical missionary training will be held from April 2nd to the 11th, 2021. If you need any further details, the pastor is suggesting that you contact the Northeastern Conference Health Ministries Department. So we want to just pray just briefly here for my pastor and good friend, Pastor Leroy Daly, as God gives him a special anointing today through his message to the people of God. Heavenly Father, I just pray a special anointing upon your manservant, dear God, as he prepares now to break the holy bread of life. I pray, dear God, that you give him a special unction to function, oh God, that we might know that we are too blessed to be stressed, too anointed to be disappointed, and too grateful to be hateful. Help us, oh God, to be willing to release that mean, that demonic, satanic, unforgiving spirit that sometimes tries to take hold of the minds of the members of the body of Christ. We pray that you'll help us to release it through this message. Lord, may an anointing so attend the message that we are free by the conclusion thereof from anything that could bind us to Satan's kingdom, that could be somehow causing us to have a backed up experience, harboring feelings of animosity and resentment towards one another, feelings, oh God, of just bad passions. I just pray your Holy Spirit will use him today as a salve to bless your people and set us free today. In Jesus' name, we pray for him. Thank you for the anointing. Thank you for overtaking his mind in such a way that some words might pop out on the screen that are not in the manuscript. May the Holy Ghost fill him and use him in a piercing, convicting manner. We pray in this very moment in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
In the image of God, we were made long ago with a purpose divine. Hear his glory to show, but we
for King or
such a Savior praise to the end of my days as I upward onward tread in the image of God.
Amen.
Amen. This poem is entitled Forgiveness. Forgiveness, one of the simplest gifts that many refuse to use. Some say, since I was hurt so bad, I must stay mad and hold a grudge until your pain is equivalent to what I had. Others say, what must I do to be saved? 100 Hail Marys? 15 times a day? And well, others pray and pray and pray, only speaking, not believing that when that their sins have been washed away. Contrary to popular demand, true forgiveness involves self, God, and man. The good book says, confess your sins to God and you'll be forgiven of any type of sin or righteous living. But when you confess, you gotta believe, or your mind is like a boat in a billowing sea. The knowledge of God's love is our greatest defense against shame, fear, guilt, and suicidal attempts. It brings peace to the mind that can never be achieved by any other kind. And when God pardons you, you can rest assured that grace covers the multitude your sins have incurred. Forgiveness shows God's justice and mercy, unchangeable character in this great controversy. But don't forget to make it right with your brother, confessing your faults one to another. At the end of the day, we are all sinners in need. Imagine if God refused to hear our petitions and pleas. It paints a portrait of heavenly things, how God's perfect love died for a world of sin and never held a grudge or demanded repay, but extended forgiveness if we requested and prayed. Forgiveness is yours today. This is God's plan, and Jesus, he is the way. If you need a model, someone to follow, well, Jesus is the best at forgiveness. Thank you and God bless.
Amen, amen, amen. I just want to say happy Sabbath to God's saints at Spring Valley and all the friends who are watching on the internet. I'm happy to be here with you to worship and to share with you today. Thank my friend, Pastor Martel, and your health ministry's leader, Sister Moore, and the entire team for the work that they have been doing right there in Spring Valley to show the power of this message that we have. Thank you, Stacey Ann, for your poem. Stacey Ann is one of our young medical missionaries. She's also the leader of all our medical missionaries. And I think I see Sister Charmaine Gabidan there, who is our executive leader for the entire Northeastern Conference and beyond. I just want to say welcome to them all. And folks, it's a health crisis that has brought us where we are today, while we are worshiping on Zoom. And when the coronavirus struck New York earlier on this year, and New York became the epicenter of the virus, we didn't know what to do, but we thought that this was God's time. And my friend and mentor, James Luke, I saw him on the program too, the person who will be doing the presentation this evening. You cannot miss it. I think it's 3 o'clock, something like that, 3 to 5. But Brother Luke is an international gospel medical missionary, trainer par excellence. And he shared the protocol with us, told us that it was 100% successful in Europe, in the Caribbean, and right here in America. I said, it couldn't be so, Brother Luke. It couldn't be so successful. So he taught a number of us the protocol, and we have teams all over the Northeast and in Florida and Georgia that administer the protocol to people who are COVID-19 positive. And we had the similar results. We deal with about 120 positive individuals. And guess what? God restored all of them to health. And you have a very good team there in Hudson Valley. So this is Adventist time to take the health message to let people know that there's a way out. And we just have to pray for all those who have been touched by COVID-19. There are many grieving families now. We just have to pray for them that God will bless them. And we have to do the best we can, trusting God to protect us as we go through these serious days. 260,000 Americans have died. I just can't believe that. And 12 million have been infected. But we're glad to know that God has a program. And for those of you who want something to help your friends or your family with, we have a website called dailyhealth.com/COVID-19 resources. Somebody could put it in the chat there. dailyhealth.com/COVID-19 resources. You can send people there. We have a documentary there of people who have contracted the virus and have bounced back. They can see their testimonies, and we have a lot of stuff there. This is our time. We can't run away. This is our time to share this health message. I also want to thank Pastor for promoting the Healing of the Nation crusade. All nations right now have been affected by the COVID-19. So in January, 8th to the 23rd, we're going to have a different type of outreach. We'll have some cooking demonstration, natural remedies, and we'll blend the gospel and help together to let the people know that there's hope. And for those of you who have not been trained, and I want to say congratulations to so many people from the Spring Valley Church who have been certified as a gospel medical missionary. On April 2nd to the 2nd to the 11th will be our next Northeastern Conference, and some more will tell you about that. So folks, I want you to keep hope alive. God is still on the throne, and Satan's power is limited. As we trust him, he will see us through. I'm going to share my screen with you now as we prepare for the message that God has given to me to share with you today. Now, you know, nobody has ever asked me to preach on the subject that I was given today. It was a very, very strange subject. And as I went through the subject, you know, my heart was touched as I was preparing the message. Man, I'm telling you, tears were coming down my eyes as I see what God has done for us. And I'm praying and I'm believing today that you will be touched to the fathomless depths of your soul as you listen to the message today. All right. So let's read this passage of scripture here. I hope you will just jot down some stuff that impress you from the message today. Amen. Luke 23, verses 32 to 43. There were also two other criminals led with him to put to death. And when they had come to the place called Calvary, there they crucified Jesus, and the criminals, one on the right hand and the other on the left hand. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." and they divided his garments and cast lots. And the people stood looking on. But even the rulers with them sneered, saying, "He saved others. Let him save himself if he is the Christ, the chosen of God." Then soldiers also mocked him, coming and offering him sour wine and saying, "If you are the king of the Jews, save yourself." Then one of the criminals who were hanged blasphemed him, saying, "If you are the Christ, save yourself." But the other answering rebuked him, saying, "Do you not even fear God, seeing you are under the same condemnation? And we indeed justified, for we receive the due reward of our deeds, but this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said to Jesus, "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus said, "Assuredly, I say unto you, today you will be with me in paradise." Let us pray. Father, I believe that where two or three are gathered together, there you are in the midst to bless us. And I know that you're here today. And bless, you are really blessing us. We have received great blessings already, but we believe that through your words, greater blessings will come. Greater blessings will come, Lord. So I pray that you'll take full control of my heart, my mind, and my spirit, and the same of everybody who is listening today, so that, Father, your name can be glorified and we can catch a picture of how amazing you are. In Jesus' name. Yes. So your leaders asked me to talk about reflecting the image of Jesus in teaching health principles. And I said, what does that mean? What is the image of Jesus that we need to reflect as we teach health principles? Because you know what happened? In the past, people used to say that the health reform people are very condemnatory, very judgmental, and very self-righteous. But we are changing that, beloved, because the main object of the medical missionary work, Ellen White says in Ministry of Healing, page 144, is to point sin-sick men and women to the man of Calvary. I want you to say that with me more again. The man of Calvary. The man of Calvary. I want you to say that for us. So that's what we're doing, to point sin-sick men and women to the man of Calvary. She says, unless we become one with him, we will be lost. So Christ is the main focus of our medical missionary work. And as I went through the message this week, it became clearer to me. And there is no greater way that Christ's image is manifested than in his nature of forgiving one another, of forgiving fallen humanity. Now, I want you to take you back to paradise, okay? Before Adam and Eve sinned, they lived in Paradise Island. I want you to put on your imaginative cap right now, beloved, right? And what was it like to be in Paradise Island? Well, it was a place that I like to describe of perfect, wholesome, healthy, harmonious relationships. That's what paradise is about. Paradise Lost was about perfect, wholesome, healthy, harmonious relationship. And when we go back to heaven, that's what it's going to be. The Bible says that the man and his wife were naked, and they felt no shame. Can you imagine that? They were naked and felt no shame. I want to think about this now, folks. God gave Adam and Eve a perfect environment where man had a perfect, wholesome relationship with God. That's a spiritual aspect of health. And where man had a perfect relationship with himself, That's the intrapersonal relationship. There was no guilt, no shame, no depression, no. And then they had a perfect interpersonal relationship. Adam and Eve were not fighting. They loved one another. And then they had a perfect relationship with the environment. No viruses, no thorns, no thistles were there. Can you imagine this? This is what God gave Adam and Eve. And all they had to do was to trust and obey him to maintain that state of perpetual bliss. But they didn't continue that way because Satan and man's disobedience affected these perfect relationship. The relationship between man and his creator was broken. The relationship between man and himself was broken. The relationship between man and woman was broken. The relationship with man and the environment was broken. Sin is terrible. It's worse than the coronavirus. Just as though we can't see the coronavirus, we can't see sin, but we can see its defective effects. We can see its destroying effects of sin, beloved. Can you see it? Wow. My thing is freezing here, but it will come back. Somebody just pray. All right. Sin wrecked and filled God's perfect creation with sickness and disease. We had mental and psychological diseases. Over 20,000 million Americans are suffering from that today. There was fear. There was guilt. There was shame. Are you suffering from any of those things today? Then there were social problems. Adam and Eve were blaming one another. Cain and Abel killed one another. Do you see what sin has caused? Do you see what this virus of sin has caused? Then there were environmental damages. Virus and thorns and thistles fill the air. Then man began to get sick and ultimately died. And man also became naked now and ashamed. That means a vacuum was created in man's heart, beloved, that no material things, no religious things, nothing that man has could fill, except it can be filled by the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. So are you capturing what happened to God's perfect creation? If you had purchased a property with all these benefits, and give it to a child or give it to a friend to look over it and they destroy it, how would you feel? Hello? How would you feel about what they've done to your property? Well, that's what happened. Adam and Eve were separated from God now. So God had a choice to destroy Adam and Eve or to forgive and reconciling them to himself. Now, that wasn't an easy choice because Adam and Eve were so ungrateful. And my grandmother used to tell me that an ungrateful child is the worst curse to a parent. But Adam and Eve were very ungrateful. God gave them 99% of everything. And the one thing that he left for himself, they had to eat of it. But you know, God's nature is forgiveness. So God's plan of redemption then is based on his forgiveness and reconciliation of mankind to himself through the costly sacrifice of Jesus Christ. I want to read that again. God's plan of redemption is based on his forgiveness and reconciliation of mankind to himself through the costly sacrifice of Jesus. Would you agree with that, my friends? If that was not in place, man and man would perish forever. But God decided to forgive them. And you know what the Bible says? This was not an on-the-spot decision. Revelation 13:8 tells us that Jesus, I want you to listen to this now, this is dynamite, was the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. So in creating the world, God foresaw that man would sin. And as a consequence of that, it was decided among the Godhead that Jesus would come and rescue mankind at an infinite sacrifice and price to himself. So we are told that when Adam and Eve sinned, the reason why they didn't die was instantaneously Jesus Christ interposed between sinful man, between a holy man, a holy God, and a sinful man. And as a result of that, Adam and Eve were not destroyed. Do you see how amazing this is, my friend? Jesus. And then the Bible says in Genesis 3:15, and I shall put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed, and he will bruise you in the head. So it shows that throughout human history, there would be people who love God and follow God, and people who love the devil and follow the devil. But the seed of the woman would come and what? Crush the serpent in his head. When was Satan's head crushed? When Jesus died on the cross of Calvary, and he exclaimed, "It is finished. It is finished." Forever, the power that Satan had over mankind was broken through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. And that's why you and I are here today. Praise God for what Jesus has done. Can somebody say amen? Even if I can't hear you, the angels will hear you. God will hear you. You will hear yourself. Man, what a God. Awesome God. So when you tell me, church, to talk about reflecting the image of God, here we're seeing it before us now. It's a forgiving God who is willing to pay infinite sacrifice by giving his son to die in our stead, that we might escape hell and live with him forever. As a result, my friends, you and I are in a battle for our souls, a battle between Christ and a battle between Satan. And as God made a decision, a choice, you and I today have to make a choice whether we will trust and obey Jesus, whether we live for him, or we live for ourselves or the devil. Young and old need to make that decision today. The only reason why people will go to hell is because they refuse Jesus. Did you know that? Because there's no other exit from hell, no other way out of hell except Jesus Christ. That's why NY says that as medical missionaries, we must become one with Jesus, or else we're going to be lost. No, man, I love this passage here, talking about what Christ has done in 2 Corinthians 5:17-21. I want you to let us go through it slowly, my friends, because we are catching more about this image of God. Now, all things are of God. Listen now, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ and has given to us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation. I don't think you catch that, or else you'll be shouting off even the internet. Even though I can't hear you, I would hear you. The Bible says that when Christ died on the cross, he reconciled all humanity to himself. So whether you know it or not, whether Biden or Trump knows it or not, you have already been reconciled. You hear that? Who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ. That is, that God in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputed their trespasses unto them. So what happened now? Christ took my place. Christ took my guilt and gave me his innocence. Christ took my unrighteousness and gave me his unrighteousness. Christ took my unrighteousness and gave me his righteousness. But although Christ has reconciled us, if we do not accept it by faith, we will not be benefited from it. Are you with me? So that's why we talk about salvation by faith. Now the devil hides this from everybody and points out our ungodliness or unworthiness. God is not mad with you. God is not mad with anybody. He took out his anger when Christ died on the cross, beloved. And he granted us our forgiveness and reconciliation even before we ask him. Even before we ask him. Amen. What a wonderful God. Do you see why I love him so much? Now then, we are ambassadors. Did you hear that, medical missionaries and my members? We're ambassadors. We are sent from the kingdom of God as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. Because we have tasted of the reconciliation power of the Lord. And the Lord is not mad with us. The Lord loves us. He says now we have a ministry. Every church member who understands what Christ has done don't have to ask to be in a personal ministry department. You already have a ministry to tell others about Christ's reconciling grace. Praise the Lord. Listen, verse 21. For he made Christ, who knew no sin, to become sin for us. Did you hear that? That we might become the righteousness of God in him. My God. So right now, if there's anybody who's listening to me and you have accepted Christ as your Savior, the Bible says, you are the righteousness of God. You are the righteousness of God. But he said, Pastor, I don't feel it. That's had nothing to do with how you feel. It's whether you will believe what God says or not. Most Adventists tend to focus on who they are in Adam. I focus on who I am in the second Adam. In the first Adam, I'm a sinner. In the second Adam, I'm a saint. In the first Adam, I'm condemned. In the second Adam, I'm justified and reconciled to God. In the first Adam, I'm weak. In the second Adam, I'm strong. In the first Adam, I'm lost. In the second Adam, my friends, I am saved. That's why the songwriter cries out, amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I once was blind, but now I see. That's all happened because of Jesus Christ. Amen. That's all happened because of Jesus Christ. And so when Christ came here, look how he operated. The Bible says that God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power. Listen to that now. Who what? Went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. So Christ's healing message was not confined to Seventh-day Adventists alone. It was free as the air that surrounds our world is free today. That unconditional loving ministry of Jesus Christ, that's what we need to do as medical missionaries, health leaders, and members of God's church. That's amazing. Now, are we talking about the image of Jesus Christ? How did Jesus relate to his disciples? My friend, this blows me away this week when I was thinking about it. In John 13, 1 to 33, you could look at that. But I want to look at John 13, 1. I want you to catch with me today. I believe the Spirit is with you anyway. Now, before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour had come, that he should depart from this world to the Father. Listen now. Having loved his own, that the disciples, who were in the world, he loved them unto the end. See, Christ knew everything about the disciples, and yet he loved them. If you see in this picture here, he was washing the disciples' feet. No master would have done that. That was the function of a slave. But Jesus showed his humility and his love for the people. See this picture here? This was a communion that very same night, 24 hours before they crucified him. Christ said, one of you going to betray me. And they were saying, is it I? Now Christ knew that they were going to betray him. And then over here, you see Judas kissing him. But let me ask you a question. If you know that somebody was going to betray you, was going to sell you as a common criminal, would you do communion and foot washing service with them? Well, Jesus did it. Would you still love them? Well, Jesus did it. If you know that somebody was going to stab you in the back like Jesus did, Judas did, would you still fellowship with them? We're talking about reflecting the image of God, which is this unconditional forgiving love that the church and the world is dying for. In verse 34 and 35, Jesus said, "By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you have love one for another." The greatest test is not the health message that will show people that you love, that Christ is Lord, but it's how we relate to people in the church. Did you hear that? "By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you have love one for the other." So the greatest thing that Spring Valley congregation can do is to love one another. Officers loving pastor, pastor loving officers, members loving one another, not just somebody in your own clique. If you want to really reflect the image of God, we have losing a lot of our children from our churches today. And Ellen White tells us that many of our young people become infidels around the dinner table. Because when we leave home and go back, we chew up the members. And the children hear this and they are very, very discouraged. So, beloved, we need to love one another by God's grace. This is an amazing thing. Come in. You have to pray here. The devil is trying to stop this, but he can't do it. We're going to win. Here's it. I just quoted this already anyway. That's why on the cross, Christ cried, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." So do you see his heart being manifested right now in living ministry? Not only said forgiveness, but in living ministry as he moved with the disciples. Now, it's amazing when he said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Look who he was asking God to forgive. The Roman soldiers who were gambling for his clothing. Right there. The criminals and the crosses to either side of him were reviling him. The religious leaders were mocking him. And the crowd was blaspheming him. Yet he said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Note, Christ was not thinking about his own feeling, his own pain. He was thinking about those people who were controlled by the devil, and the soldiers were doing this in ignorance. Folks, that's the spirit that God wants us to manifest, you know, among us, and as we teach the health principle. Surrounded by this most unworthy bunch, Jesus prayed, "Father, forgive them." My friend, it's a prayer of unmatched mercy and love. Even in his agony, Jesus' concern was for forgiving of those who counted themselves among the enemies. He asked the Father to forgive the thieves and the cross who jeered him, the Roman soldiers who mocked him, who spat on him, who beat him, who yanked out his beard, who whipped him, who put a crown of thorns on his head and nailed him to the cross. Jesus asked for forgiveness for the angry mob that had mocked him and called for his crucifixion. "Father, forgive them." He was putting into practice the principle he had taught in the Sermon on the Mount when he said, "You have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemies. But I tell you, love your enemies. Pray for those who persecute you." Jesus, the persecuted, was now praying for the persecutor. Man, what a savior. Man, what a God. What a wonderful savior is Jesus, my Jesus. What a wonderful savior is Jesus, my Lord. Folks, let's exalt him today. Let's lift him up today. Reflecting the image of God. Now that we have seen, get a small glimpse. Ellen White says that throughout the ceaseless ages of eternity, we'll be studying the mystery of redeeming grace. I do not have pen to portray. I don't have voice to say how great this thing has been. But it's our time now to look upon Jesus. Sinless is he. Father, impute his life unto me. My life of scarlet, my sin and woe. Impute his life unto me. How are we going to reflect it now? Ephesians chapter 4, verse 29, Paul was talking to the church. He said, let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for edification, that it may impart grace to the hearers. So it means that you can't talk good before a member and then talk bad behind them. If you're going to really reflect the image of God, and do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. See, let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. All these things grieve the Holy Spirit of God, my friends, and we cannot live out the image of God unless by his grace we clear up our hearts, we clear up our minds. Man, and then the verse come now. Be kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake has forgiven you. That's the foundation of us forgiving others, meditating upon, thinking through how much Christ has forgiven me. And can anybody do me anything, does anything to me that I have not done to Christ and yet Christ forgiven me? So in reflecting the image of Christ, the most important thing to do is to look upon what Christ has done for me. And if he could have forgiven me so many times, I can forgive my brother and sisters. Hear what Ellen G. White said in Counsel and Diets and Food, page 460. He was talking to health reformers now. Of all the people in the world, reformers should be the most unselfish, the most kind, the most courteous. In their lives, should be seen the true goodness of unselfish deeds. Praise the Lord. The worker who manifests a lack of courtesy, who shows impatience at the ignorance or waywardness of others, who speak hastily or act thoughtlessly, may close the door to the heart so that he can never reach them. Wow, did you hear that? As you seek to draw others within the circle of Christ's love, let the purity, listen now, of your language, the unselfishness of your service, the joyfulness of your demeanor, bear witness to the power of what, everybody? The power of his grace. Give to the world so pure and righteous a representation of him that men shall behold him in his beauty. My God, that's what we are called to do. It's of little use to try to reform others by attacking what we may regard as wrong habits. Such effort often result in more harm than good. Oh, Counsel on Diets and Food 459. So we as health reformers must be the most courteous. And for that to happen, we're going to have to learn to let go. We're going to have to learn to forgive some of the hurts that have been done to us. So today, my friends, are you struggling to reflect the forgiving image of Jesus Christ? Look upon Jesus and you'll get power. Now, in Luke 17, verse 1 to 6, Jesus was speaking to the disciples and he said, take heed to yourself, guys. If your brother sin against you, rebuke him. And if he repents, forgive him. And if he sins against you seven times in a day, and seven times in a day returns to you saying, I repent, you shall forgive him. Now, that's not an easy. The rabbi said it should be three times, but Jesus said, no, it's seven times. No, is there anybody in this congregation who has reached this level of spirituality who could be willing to forgive you seven? And seven is a perfect number. When the apostles heard that, they said, Lord, increase our faith. When you think about faith, you think about some will move mountains. But here now, the disciples saying, this is a rough thing, Jesus. And for me to do it, for us to do it, you have to increase our faith. Is there anybody here today who is feeling like the disciples? You have some spouse who run out on you, some children who are ungrateful to you, some co-workers who are jealous over you, some members who speak ill of you, and you know you're going to have to forgive them if you want to reflect the image of Jesus. Do you need an increased faith? Well, the Lord said, if you have faith as the mustard seed, you can say to this mulberry tree, be pulled up by the roots and be planted in the sea, and it shall be done. So Christ was saying, you don't need a big faith. You just need enough faith in me, not in your own strength. And you shall say to this mulberry tree, it is said that the mulberry tree can live for 600 years. And there are certain hurts, certain wounds that have been created in our hearts that are living from generation to generation. And it's only by faith in the forgiving Son of God that these roots can be uprooted. Some of us are dying. Some of us blood pressure will not go down. Some of us diabetes will not go down. Some of us cancers will not be healed until we get rid of the bitterness that is inside of us by faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Why should we forgive? That's the way we reflect the image of God. One, we reflect the image of God. Two, forgiving is the only way to be fear to yourself. People have said forgiving is just not fear. When they say that forgiving is not fear, I tell them that forgiving is the only way to be fear to yourself. Did you hear that, folks? Would it be fear to you that the person who hurt you once goes on hurting you the rest of your life? That person may be dead and gone, so it's not fear to you. When you refuse to forgive, you are giving the person who hurt you once the privilege of hurting you all over again. My Lord, do you want that to continue? The first person to get the benefit of forgiving is a person who does the forgiving. Say that with me, my friends. The first person to get the benefits of forgiving is a person who does the forgiving. Forgiving is going to release you from all form of bitterness and hurt. Listen to this video that I like to show now. Listen to this. Wow. It played today. I don't know why it's not playing now, but let me see if I can get it. All right. I'm sorry, it can't, it's not playing today. That's all right, the Lord knows, it's his message. So what this video was showing, that those who carry unforgiveness, it poisons your soul, it becomes bitter. 61% of people with cancer has chronic unforgiveness issues. Did you hear that, my friend? So the bitterness, the anger is eating them out and poisoning their souls. So you have to forgive if you want to be healed. Are you with me, everybody? All right. So the second thing that forgiveness doesn't mean reunion. Some people think that if you forgive somebody you once trusted, it means that you must go back in the same relationship with him or her that you had before. Not necessarily so. Forgiveness does not mean reunion. For your own safety, you may have to love some people from a distance. Do you understand me? They want to kill you. They're abusive. But what you can do, whenever you have a chance of doing good to them, by the grace of God, doing good to them, just like how Jesus did it. Well, some people said, well, if you don't have to wait until he or she says, I'm sorry, you have to wait until somebody said, yeah, sorry, but you don't have to. Some people believe that you should not forgive anyone who wronged you unless he or she crawls back on his knees saying he or she is sorry and begs you to forgive. Well, if you wait for that person who hurt you to repent, you may have to wait forever. And then you are the one who is stuck with the pain, bitterness, and anger, and ill health. If you wait for the person who hurt you to say, I'm sorry, you are giving her permission to keep on hurting you as long as you live. So do you see that forgiveness benefits the one who forgives? Wow. Remember now that God's forgiveness is available before we ask for it. Christ said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Nobody had asked him for forgiveness. But he looked beyond their faults and saw that this was the only way they could make it. Only way they could make it if they received forgiveness. Wow. Forgiveness is also a journey, beloved. Some people suppose that you should be able to forgive everything in a single instance. No. You have to be patient with yourself. When the wound goes very deeply, it's going to take some time. And God will see you through. So be patient with yourself. Be patient with yourself. The grace of God will work through you and to bring it to my friends. You know, I love this quotation. If you want to be a saint in heaven, you must first be a saint on earth. The trait of character you cherish in life will not be changed by death or by the resurrection. So the time to make things right is now. The time to make things right is today. You and I could have been one of the 255,000 coronavirus positive individuals who died, but we're alive today. No one should leave this place today without making a decision to make things right with those who have offended you. And what continues in the book? You will come up from the grave with the same disposition you manifest in your home and society. Now is the time to change, beloved. I quoted this passage when I was preaching at a church. I like to tell the story. And while I was preaching, a tall man came from the back of the church. And while I was making my appeal and said, Pastor, before you complete the appeal, I want to say something. You know, I am the first elder of this church. And everybody knows that the pastor and I are at loggerheads. The pastor and I are fighting. I've said some nasty things about the pastor. But when you read that, the same way I go down in the grave is the same way I will come up. Man, something sparks off in my heart and tells me that I have to make things right today because I don't want to die this way. So he came up and he was right there in the pulpit, called up the pastor who was there and confessed right before the pastor, asked the pastor for forgiveness. And the character of that service was changed because one man, big man, was willing to confess his misgivings and to ask for forgiveness. Today, as we bring this thing to its close, beloved, is there anybody here who needs not only to ask God to forgive you, but to forgive somebody who has harmed you? Remember, Jesus bore our sins on the tree. See him there? The spikes were driven in his hand. And he forgave those people who drove the spikes in his hand. And through those stripes today, you and I are healed. And I'm here to tell you today, my friends, that Jesus can break every chain of unforgiveness, every bitterness in your life, if you will just look to him and depend upon his grace. He will break every chain today if you are willing to do that. Are you willing today? Who is it today? Who is willing today to forgive and to let God have his own way? Were it not for the grace of Christ, we would not be here today. And that grace is marvelous. That grace is flowing today. And we're going to hear someone sing that grace. And then I'm going to pray for you today that God's image will be reflected in you, in forgiving those who have hurt you, were it not for grace.
measured out my day. Life carried me along. In my soul I yearned to follow God, but knew I'd never be so strong. I looked hard at this world to learn how heaven could be gained, just to end where I began.
Thank you, my daughter. As we are about to pray, the beloved, I just want you to bow your heads a little and just think about God's amazing grace to you. He has forgiven you long before you ask. He has reconciled you to God long before you even thought about it. It is already done, but you have to respond to his forgiveness and reconciliation by faith. Today, you should just want to praise him, Lord. I thank you that in spite of me, you have saved me from my wretchedness and from hell. And I will serve you for the rest of my life. talk to the Lord right now where you are and ask him and thank him and praise him for saving you. And for those who are on YouTube and Facebook, I just want you to just right there and let us know if you're accepting God's grace. Somebody from this church will get back to you. For those of you who are on Zoom, writing in the chat, say, right now, I was not saved before now. But right now, when I see how amazing God's grace is, I am yielding myself to him and ask him to forgive me and receive him as my Lord and Savior. That's number one. Number two, you may say, I want to get some more Bible studies from this church so I can learn more about this amazing grace and this wonderful help message. Just put it there. Put your email and your cell phone if you can, or just your email, and we will get back to you. We'll get back to you. And for those who are not yet medical missionaries, and you realize that the focus of the medical missionary is to point sin sick men and women to this man of Calvary who we just spoke to you about, and you would say, I want to train to be another medical missionary next, at the next training, put it there, and Sister Moore will get it. And God is going to bless you real good. Father, man, what a God. We are thankful, oh God, for your grace, your amazing grace, which saves a wretch like me and like us today. This grace is flowing right now. This grace is also the power of God unto salvation. So those of us who need power to live like Jesus, to reflect the image of Jesus as we share this health message, help us to know that we have to look up on Jesus every day. And he will impute his life unto us so that as we move among our brothers and sisters, as we move among the world, they will sense the same love, the same unconditional love that came from Jesus. It will be coming through us today because we're now reflectors of his image. And Lord, I pray that those who feel down today, you will lift them up. Let them know that where sin abound, grace does much more abound. Yes, I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. So deeply, deeply staying within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry, and from those waters lifted me. Now safe I am. Praise the Lord. Your love lift us up now and put us on solid ground. Those who may be depressed today, I pray that you'll break the depression in the name of Jesus of Nazareth. I pray for those who are sick in body, sick in mind, sick in spirit. I pray that your word right now will go forward and give them release, give them restoration. May they receive it by faith right now. Let them know that your healing grace and mercy is flowing right now, and it's up to them by the grace of God to receive it by faith and to praise you and thank you. Continue to bless Sister Moore and Pastor as they lead out in this help message in this area. We have a great program coming up this evening. Help us to come back so we can see more of how gracious you are to us. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Would you be free from the burden of sin? There is power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There is wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power. Yeah.
certainly want to thank each of you for tuning in to our broadcast today. What a spiritful message. And we pray that each one of you who have honed into our message today were truly blessed and edified by that heartfelt message which was brought to us by our presenter, Pastor Leroy Daly. Father, forgive them. Yes, there is no recourse or escape. We must pray that indeed Christ will help us to cultivate a forgiving spirit, which at times is not the easiest thing in the world to do. It can come at times as a very strong challenge, but nonetheless, it is the wish and the will of our Father to forgive. And we too must have a heart that is willing to forgive, since none of us are perfect. We have our besetting sins and defection that needs help, especially in days and times like these when the powers of darkness are doubled on the people of God. So let us keep one another in prayer and ask God to help us to cultivate and to exercise that spirit of forgiveness that Jesus displayed on the cross. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Pastor Daly, again, we want to thank you for that great message of forgiveness and reconciliation. I don't see you on the screen, but if you are hearing us, we just want you to know that we appreciate you allowing the Lord to use you today by his Spirit. I know that you mentioned earlier that nobody said anything to you, and you know that I didn't say anything to you. None of the church officials or members said anything to you, but I believe from the bottom of my heart that the Holy Ghost spoke directly to you and through you as you brought that spirit-filled message today. And I just want you to know that you are indeed a clear and uncertain tone and conduit of the Most High God, a mouthpiece indeed, a Nabi, declaring his will at this time for his people, because only the Holy Ghost could turn you to bring the message that you brought today if you were unaffected by human beings. Divinity took you over, and you said exactly what we needed today, even more than a mouthful. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, God eternal, we thank you so much, Lord, for the ministry of your manservant, Pastor Leroy A. Daly. Not just the health ministry, oh God, not just his pastoral ministry, dear God, but the love and passion that he shares with your people and the deep burden that you have put on his heart and soul for lost souls, which is resulting from the impassioned love and attitude that he has for you. A heart, big-hearted person full of love and such deep aspirations for the cause of God, that the gospel be spread into all the world, that many souls in New York City will return to you. Father, please let him live long enough to realize his dream, to see thousands of medical missionaries just moving like ants all around about the five boroughs of New York City. Touch the ministry. Bless him, oh God. May countless numbers of souls come to the foot of the cross via his ministry, and may many stars be placed in his crown that will in turn be turned over to Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Thank you, Father, for hearing our prayers. Thank you for blessing us, Lord, with opportunities to repent, to turn, to be forgiven and sealed before it is eternally too late. Thank you for the chance. Thank you for probation. Thank you for salvation. And again, thank you for that heart-piercing, touching, soul-stirring message that you have given us today through your manservant, Pastor and Dr. Leroy A. Daly. Bless him, Lord. Continue to further his ministry. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Tune in this evening for AYM at 3 p.m. on Facebook, YouTube, and our website, and Vespers at 4 p.m. on our conference line. Until next time, God bless.